Nice to see so many people here. Let's unpack the chairs so that people can sit along the wall.
I don't even need this one, actually.
I'm Christine Mitchell. I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Bioethics. This is Bob Prue coming in, who's the Faculty Director, and there are a number of our fellows along with others here. I want to introduce to you Paul McLean, whom I have known for more years than I'm counting, who wrote the book that we're going to be talking about today, Bloodlines, and he will tell you about that. I want to tell you that in addition to his background as a sports writer for the LA Daily News, after he married Jody, who is also here, and they had a child that some of you have read about, became a stay-at-home dad and also continues to be, as you know, a writer. In addition, the way I got to know him is that he became a member of Harvard's Community Ethics Committee, which is a group that Carol Powers and others who were interested in bringing the public voice into bioethical issues that people in hospitals are facing put together. And so he has served both on the board of Community Voices in Medical Ethics and on that Community Ethics Committee, and has been the chief writer for the MedEthics and Me blog that Community Voices in Medical Ethics, that Paul does, or mostly does. He just told me that he was in recently to record for WBUR a reading that he did based on a piece he wrote for Cognoscenti about Hutch, whom you see here, is the dog that he will tell you more about. I also, lastly, before I turn this over to Paul, just want to say that Martha Montello, who is on our faculty and teaches the narrative ethics course in the graduate program and directs the writing support program for our master's students, had planned to be here. And unfortunately, she lives, well, it's not unfortunate that she lives in Kansas, but they are getting slammed with a snowstorm that meant she had to leave earlier today than she had originally planned to go. And so I'm going to try and channel Martha a little bit, and as we get to have a conversation about this book and the work that stories like this do in addressing ethical questions. So Paul's going to start, and then we'll, for about half an hour or so, and then we have a little less than an hour for conversation about Bloodlines and about the kind of book that Bloodlines is. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Christine. And feel free to, I brought a couple of copies you can pass around and people can have a look and get a sense of what it is I'll be talking about. So I was very, as you can imagine, I don't do this very often, I was very nervous this morning. And I was trying to get, okay, how am I going to, like, stay in my skin today before this thing? And so I did something that I used to do most weeks when I was in the fellowship here every Friday morning. And I listened to this podcast of the show On Being. And it was timely this week because it was this interview with this 90-year-old, what is his name, David Steindl Rast. And he's this 90-year-old Catholic-turned-Buddhist monk. And he was all talking about gratitude. And it was, I mean, and this guy could parse it out. It was like gratitude as distinct from gratefulness, as distinct from thankfulness. And I could not begin to sort it out like the way he did. And yet my story is, if it's about anything, it's about gratitude. Because it's about, you know, having my daughter's life saved. And anytime I'm in the presence of physicians and nurses and people who work in medical care, it's like, that's the first thing I want to remember to say is thanks. So with that, and I'll try not to read completely and try to be a little more present, but I get lost if I don't have it written down, so bear with me. And I will explain the dog to you later, but as I'm kind of having this emerging new career that I'm creating for myself, I'm doing a lot of social media. And since cute animals are kind of the heart and soul of social media, I figured I could start cheaply by introducing you to my dog that way. So I'm not going to name everybody who's here, but I do want to take note that the graphic artist who created my book cover is here, Kristen. She told my whole story in a page. She told the whole story in a page, so she's a lot more succinct than I am. My wife Jody is also here, along with other family and friends who know this story very well. They were participants in it. Hey, Patrick. And in part, my story is an appreciation of the sustaining power of family and community in a very difficult time. Pediatric medicine often struggles to understand the interests of the patient separate from the family, and it's not so easily done. Autonomy becomes like a fiction we cling to. So the title of my book is Bloodlines. It begins in Scotland in 2005 when I was boring my daughter with reminders that this is where her people are from. And all the while, her real bloodline, the one that was keeping her alive and well, was disappearing. And it took a stranger's bloodline to save her, and it did. So amid my awe and wonder and gratitude, I became obsessed with this fact. My daughter was cured of an illness that would have killed me as a child. There was no cure, and then over the course of my lifetime, there was. And that's extraordinary. But how did that happen? Even after writing this book, I still ask that. How did that happen? So it's a real honor to be invited to speak here, in this room especially. A lot of great discussions took place in this room. When I was in the Bioethics Fellowship, most of the lectures were in here, and I more than once heard that an issue seemed less about ethics than it was about communication. And I don't accept the distinction. Good communication is the foundation of good ethics, but it's time consuming. Good communication just takes time. And doctors never have that. That's one thing they just don't have anymore. So this is what makes health literacy so important and informed consent so difficult to achieve. But I'm not a clinician, and I have no history as a medical or social science lecturer or educator. I'm a writer with a story. So this will be a little different from the usual in this room. And I'm especially grateful for the opportunity to connect my story with bioethics, the conscience, I think, of medicine. So I'll begin with two bookends. There he is. One is from my childhood. Engineer Bill taught me to drink milk. He had a TV show with a regular bit called Green Light, Red Light. When the light was green, you drank your milk. When it was red, you stopped. If you gulped, you lost. If you drank at the wrong time, you lost. You won if you stopped when you were supposed to and proceeded when you were supposed to. So with milk as a metaphor, Engineer Bill could be an ethicist. So the other bookend, last summer around the time my year in the fellowship was ending, Harvard psychologist Steven Pinker wrote a column in the Boston Globe, memorable for a phrase directed at bioethics, "Get out of the way." In other words, no red light. So Steven Pinker is my other bookend. So there is no one thing in my daughter's illness and cure that inspired my interest in bioethics. But when Engineer Bill was on the air in the 1950s, if you were a kid with severe aplastic anemia, you died. No exceptions. And though Pinker might call this woolly thinking, it's useful to me to remember that while kids like me were learning when to stop and when to go, the Tuskegee syphilis experiments on African American men were in their third decade and would continue into the 1970s without a red light. But my story is not about Pinker or Tuskegee, but instead a consideration of one real experience of scientific progress in clinical medicine and amusing about social conscience. By the time Steven Pinker declared a green light, aplastic anemia had become treatable and often curable, sometimes even for patients with no donor match. I think Pinker assumes research is more capable of self-policing than I do, and yet he's on to something with get out of the way. Knowing when is the challenge. So this is a this photo is a couple months probably after the transplant, and we're at the we're looking up at the climbing mountain at the REI in Seattle. And my daughter, who would ultimately climb that mountain, she was kind of envisioning, boy, am I going to be able to do that at some point? So I love that photo. So a little,
you?
Oh, that is me. Yes, you're shocked.
I've never seen you from that angle somehow.
Is this a good thing or is this a?
That's
this
a good.
Okay.
That's Jay.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. That's my. Yeah. That's Jay. So a little background. I left my career in newspapers to become a stay-at-home dad when my daughter was 3. No regrets. One of the best things I ever did. I went from working 60-hour weeks in a stressful business to being a full-time parent. That was a privilege. But when the illness nearly killed her, it also stripped it bare any illusions that I could protect her. I had to rely on others, and I did. Trust had so much to do with that. So I guess it's no mystery that I would emerge from the Ethics Fellowship as a communitarian with a healthy respect for the idea of autonomous choice, but a healthier respect for its limitations. I'm now the father of a young adult who, as a child, was cured of aplastic anemia by bone marrow transplant. She's my only child. And writing a book about that cure, I came to understand in a very different way, a very personal way, the science that allowed it to happen. Some of that science might get a red light today, and maybe deserve it. My question is, how long can you wait for benefit to outweigh harm? In other words, how do you consider harm to one patient with benefit for another 50 years apart? I'd suggest there's no justifying this without considering the common good and the powerful motivation to treat suffering and cure disease through advancing science and understanding. My daughter's cure would not have been possible without a high regard for the common good and the future patient. For almost a decade, I've completed a lengthy questionnaire from the Seattle Cancer Care Alliance about my daughter and her health. I completed the last one earlier this year. My daughter is 18 now, and it becomes her responsibility. The questionnaire always is accompanied by quotes from transplant survivors. Some are pure gratitude. Others are mixed. Still others of the wish I knew then what I know now variety. For the latter, chronic graft versus host disease is an unexpected burden. Not all of the quotes are from survivors. Some are from family, grateful or grieving. And though the quotes specifically concern stem cell transplant, I shared some of them with the Community Ethics Committee when we were studying listing criteria for organ transplant. The quotes informed the committee's report to Children's Hospital and the Harvard Ethics Leadership because they were helpful in understanding the emotional aftermath of transplant. There's really no reliable way to predict the outcome of transplant or to prepare a hopeful patient or family. Patients want the cure and tend not to think about the aftermath. We were very lucky. Post-transplant for us was better than we expected. Not as good as it is now, a lot better than it was before. That's my simple understanding of research progress. Weighing harm in the short term with benefits in the long term is more art than science. And it requires of patients and research participants that altruism carry significant weight among ethical values. Not long after the transplant, before my daughter was released from Seattle Children's Hospital, my wife commented on the surprising absence of graft versus host disease in even a minor way. And the physician's assistant, a guy named Dow, smiled and said, "That's why transplant docs love aplastic anemia." That might have been the first time someone said that. We were in the midst of something extraordinary. As Christine mentioned, I used to be a sports writer. It's going back quite a few years. But last year, after the Patriots beat Seattle in the Super Bowl, I wrote a love letter to Seattle that the Seattle Times published. And an elderly, I'm not going to revisit that story, but there was an elderly woman in Seattle who read the story, found my number, and called me. So bear with me a moment. hopefully you can all hear this.
I just wanted to call and thank you for being very good about the academia. We had two boys who had it, but they were much age difference. I think it was in the 50s when we were trying to get a solution to the problem. I'll have to call you back because I'm calling from Washington State. And I'd really like to talk to you, Mr. McLean. Okay. Thank you.
You're going to have to repeat what that says. That was in the 50s.
Yeah. So I never met, could everybody hear that sort of? I mean, it's not a great quality. So I never met this woman. She didn't leave her name or number, and she never called back. All I have is this recording, which I play today for two reasons. One is personal. The essential thing I want as a writer is for a reaction for one person, from one person, that what I wrote touched them. But for several years working with the Community Ethics Committee, I've studied profound quandaries in clinical medicine. We rarely stray far from end-of-life issues. More recently, I've been drawn to research ethics, again as a community member, through volunteer work with the Research Subject Advocacy Board at Harvard Catalyst, and now as a co-investigator on a pending study. The study is part of what is known as patient-centered outcomes research, which is an Obamacare initiative that seeks to determine what's most important to patients, involving them throughout the process. And in a way, the multidisciplinary nature of bioethics has expanded, or is expanding, to include the patient, family, and community perspective. And I think this is a good thing. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. So here's the second reason I wanted to play this recording. A half century earlier, this call was from the 1950s, this woman was me, showing up at the hospital desperate and pleading for some kind and skilled stranger to do something to save her child. That happened to both of us. But there was nothing to do for her sons. It was the 1950s, and her sons died from aplastic anemia. She didn't say that specifically on the message, but that's what happened. A half century later, my daughter was cured. And in a way, my good fortune was from the response over time to her plea to doctors to do something. And that essentially is what my book, Bloodlines, is about. So Edward Pellegrino is someone I'd like to read more of. Maybe some of the fellows and master's students have read him already. He taught his medical students three questions. What can be wrong, what can be done, and what ought to be done? That's a simple and useful checklist. I think about the woman from Seattle who lost two sons, and myself, whose daughter was saved. Do something, we plead. Her sons died. My daughter was cured, and in half century's time, it became possible to do something. Getting there was a long, slow process. In that time, scientists came to understand tissue typing. The blood supply, deadly for some as recently as the 1980s, improved. New drugs bolstered immune response. The immune suppressant cyclosporin was developed and gave doctors a tool to control graft versus host disease. If I ever do a new edition of Bloodlines, I'll give a lot more attention to that miracle drug. I'm a member of the Ethics Advisory Committee at Children's Hospital, and it seems like every month I sit in at the meeting and I'm overwhelmed by stories of children and their families in horrible circumstances, facing impossible choices. And the doctors and nurses of children seeking clarity on the Pellegrino question, what ought to be done? In thinking about the scientific process of getting from children dying in the 1950s to children cured in the 21st century, I have two more questions. How long is ethical memory? And how forgiving? These are moral questions, maybe a little woolly, as Steven Pinker might say. I don't really expect answers, but it might be worth discussing. My daughter's cure owes debts to human victims of mustard gas in World War I and to human victims of the atom bomb. Those horrific events on a massive scale were hardly intended as research, and yet lessons learned and questions inspired contributed in crucial ways to my daughter's cure. Which means my daughter, alive and well in 2016, benefited from harms to others suffered years earlier, as do many treatments and cures. And forgive my oversimplifying, But the impetus for looking at chemo and radiation in that way came from the Seattle woman and her two sons dead from aplastic anemia. They would have been about my age now. She probably said more or less the same thing as another mother more recently at the International Summit on Human Gene Editing. This woman had also lost a child to something that may become curable. Needless to say, she's not a fan of a ban or a moratorium on gene editing. Just frickin' do it, she said. Just frickin' do it. At this point, I ought to be clear about something. I feel no ambivalence about the moral goodness of my daughter's cure, and I absolutely understand just frickin' do it. I probably said something pretty close to that myself. And yet, how does a person of conscience come to terms with what is essentially collateral benefit of harm done decades before? I've developed a great tolerance for ambiguity. As a coping mechanism, it may be the best I can do. But I've also developed a strong belief in research oversight. So, forgive the darkness of this photo. I hope you can see it. This dark photo from the New York Times is of a woman in rural China extracting from pig intestines what will become the anticoagulant heparin. Heparin was vital to my daughter's cure. She became expert at injecting it. We had a tray and a checklist. Latex gloves, saline solution, heparin flush, two or three sanitary wipes to meticulously clean the tip and cap of her Hickman line. That photo still gives me a chill, and I link the woman directly to a continuum of which my daughter's cure is part. Pigs and their intestines contributed to my daughter's cure through intentional, authentic research. Also bears and their bile, immune-suppressing serum from horses and pigs. I owe a lot to pigs, even more to mice, everything to beagles. Beagles are the last step before the clinical trials. From this curative menagerie, I can't forget the medical scientists. One of them was Eloise Giblet. More on her in a moment. My daughter is now a high school senior. She was 7 when she was diagnosed with severe aplastic anemia. The most frightening of her symptoms was that she couldn't stop bleeding. All of a sudden, for no reason we ever determined, she lost her immune system and any ability to restore it. But 80 transfusions later, most of them just down the street at Boston Children's Hospital, she got a new immune system. Her marrow donor was a 20-something med student who is now a practicing pediatrician. We're Facebook friends. There she is with my daughter. One morning in spring 2006, she traveled from Columbia, South Carolina to Wake Forest, had her marrow harvested through her hip. All she knew about my daughter was girl, 8 years old, aplastic anemia. The bag was placed in a cooler and put on a FedEx plane to Seattle. The guy who brought it from the airport looked like he could have been delivering pizza. A little before midnight, it was hooked up by a nurse to a pole beside my daughter's bed and began to drip into her through the Hickman line that was invented by a scientist approaching retirement when we were in Seattle. That it was possible to use a stranger's marrow to restore my daughter's marrow was astounding to me. It still is. The reason I even know Eloise Giblet's name is from seeing her obituary in 2009 and learning she was a hematologist who did early science crucial to bone marrow transplantation. She worked with transplant pioneer Donald Thomas, a name I knew. I saw his portrait every time we stepped off the elevator on the 5th floor at the Seattle Cancer Care Alliance. He became like a saint in stained glass. So Donald Thomas was a Harvard medical grad. Let me get back to him. There he is. He was a Harvard medical grad from Texas whose first lab was in the original Jimmy Fund building. He spent a lot of time with Sidney Farber on the leukemia ward at the Brigham. What a grim place that was. Frightened children in a lot of pain, little to offer other than compassion and maybe a bag of blood, a lot of crying and a lot of dying, the sort of place where a parent like me might be found pleading with the doctor to do something, the sort of place that would cause a doctor to try just about anything to stop a family's suffering and find a cure. Medicine and research were part and parcel then. Donald Thomas cared for the first child to go into remission with leukemia. At the Brigham, one long block from here, he cared for the first kidney transplant patient of the of his colleague Joseph Murray. In 1990, the two of them won the Nobel Prize for Medicine. Another lab at the Brigham got Thomas interested in growth factors. In fall 2005, a shot of growth factors failed to get a response from my daughter's dead marrow. 8 months later, another shot of growth factors is what kickstarted her new marrow and got us out of the hospital. So Donald Thomas moved his lab from here to Cooperstown, where he studied radiation's effect on beagles at Bassett Hospital. For the record, Bassett was named for a philanthropist, not a hound. Then in the 60s, Thomas moved to Seattle, where decades later, my daughter got a second chance. Not long ago, I met a retired pediatrician at a Center for Bioethics event. He was curious about my family's experience. He said he'd been a neighbor of Sidney Farber in Newton. When I told him we had left Boston to have the transplant done in Seattle, he walked away in mid-sentence. I had offended him. I didn't have a chance to explain how collaborative Boston and Seattle were. And it was a remarkable collaboration, it still is. So why would my family leave the extraordinary resources of Boston Children's and Dana-Farber about a mile from our home for Seattle? The long answer is in bloodlines. The short answer is so we could participate in a phase 3 clinical trial specific to severe aplastic anemia that would use significantly less toxic means to prepare my daughter for her new marrow. Boston was on deck to join this multi-center study, but wasn't ready to begin when we needed it. It might sound grandiose to say my daughter's treatment came in the midst of a paradigm shift, but it definitely came amid a reimagining of the standard of care for aplastic anemia, and at a time when studies of disease involving stem cells became out of date almost in real time. Our daughter's emotional well-being was a big concern for my wife and I, and that favored not leaving Boston, where we had family and extended support community. Many of them are here today. My wife and I believed our daughter's life might be saved in either place, but in balancing benefit and harm, we became convinced that less toxic conditioning might save more of her life. Before getting on the plane west, we agreed that our decision was the right one, and we accepted that we might be wrong. So far, so good. Our daughter is cured, healthy, and about to leave for college. And back to Eloise Giblet. The ELO antigen is named for her. She's among that generation of medical scientists for whom antigen came to mean something. ELO and her colleagues figured out tissue typing and the role that it plays in a body's acceptance of a stranger's marrow. Transplant had only worked with identical twins before tissue typing began to be understood. Mice and beagles, bred for the purpose, were crucial to figuring this out. My daughter participated in a phase 3 study to find the minimal amount of the chemo drug cyclophosphamide necessary for conditioning. But we'd really gone to Seattle to keep the total body irradiation low. In retrospect, our decision was very much a weighing of benefit and harm within our family. There was plenty of each whether we left for Seattle or stayed in Boston. It was ultimately an informed guess, a leap of faith, really. The bioethicists debate the distinction between clinical care and research, and whether the distinction is still worth making. They were essentially one and the same in the early days of bone marrow transplantation, and to some degree it was ethicists who made the distinction important in response to abuses such as Tuskegee. By the time of my daughter's transplant, medicine and research were cautiously coming back together in the uneasy alliance known as translational science. Now here we are, hearing what ought to be done is for bioethics to get out of the way of countless cures just waiting to be found. I'm all for better and faster cures, but I think Steven Pinker assumes too much about the checks in place for potential abuses in research. And maybe he takes trust for granted. That's a mistake of privilege. A year or so ago, I watched a webcast of the Institute of Medicine workshop on informed consent and health literacy. A physician from UC San Francisco named Alicia Fernandez said something remarkable. She said most of her medical students did not know about the Tuskegee syphilis experiments. That stunned me. I mean, you can become a doctor and not know about Tuskegee? Then Dr. Fernandez added, but my patients know about Tuskegee. Her patients know. So that disconnect between physicians and patients is what makes this a good time, I think, for the bioethics dialogue to engage the patient, family, and extended community, which is as necessary as it is problematic. Some of us being card-carrying, woolly thinkers. I'm one of the 5 community members of the Children's Hospital Ethics Advisory Committee, and it's impressive how Children's invites and welcomes perspectives from outside the institution. It's a very good model. Also intriguing to me is the patient-centered outcomes research initiative. I'm really just getting started in work on this. I don't know a lot about it, but I'm eager to begin work in earnest on it in the spring. In my daughter's care, I don't distinguish the phase 3 clinical trial from standard treatment. In my mind, they are essentially one and the same, one being an improvement on the other. But it matters to me to remember that the field of bioethics itself emerged during the era in which bone marrow transplant was developed. Donald Thomas was putting his Seattle team together when Henry Beecher, the Harvard anesthesiologist, wrote what's considered the single most influential paper ever written about experimentation involving human subjects. There were no institutional review boards in the early years of transplant science. No presidential commission, no Belmont report, mostly philosophical debates over semantics. Balancing benefit and harm was done mainly by physicians. We know from events that led to the first President's Commission that oversight was sorely lacking. There was no bioethics to get out of the way. But back to Dr. Giblet. After I read her obituary and learned of her connection to Donald Thomas's Nobel Prize-winning work on bone marrow transplantation, I emailed a hematologist friend in Seattle to ask if he had known her. He had, and he sent me the email address of her lone survivor. So I wrote a short note and said who I was and that my daughter had been cured by bone marrow transplant. And I said, thanks. She wrote back, thanks for your email. Thanks for your email. Elo used to tell me when she first worked on research around the possibility of bone marrow transplants, people would pick at the hutch and say they were experimenting on and killing children. She and the other great scientists at the hutch persevered. And I'm proud that she was my aunt. I grew up going to the blood center with her on Saturdays and watching her work. She was an amazing woman. So that also stunned me. The idea that a woman directly connected to my daughter's cure had been considered a baby killer by some. But into the mid-1960s, transplant results were such painful failures that even Thomas stopped trying. The only early transplants that worked involved perfectly matched siblings. Typing for the human leukocyte antigen was not understood. But by 1967, when Thomas resumed his clinical work in Seattle, he had made important advances with his Cooperstown dogs. He had identified genetic markers on white blood cells, markers of histocompatibility that permitted close matching of donor and recipient. And he observed consistently successful grafts among his beagles. According to Jerome Groopman, prominent scientists were harsh critics of Donald Thomas, even as he began assembling his clinical and research team in Seattle. Groopman says that what made Thomas unique was his persistence. So at this point, I probably don't need to say I'm a little bit obsessed with the scientific development of knowledge that made it possible for my daughter to be cured of a disease that would have killed me when I was her age, and that did kill that Seattle woman's sons. And I'm not quite sure what to make of the fact people directly responsible for creating the cure were considered baby killers by some. Were they all cranks? Were they right? I'm pretty sure the Seattle woman was not among them. So. Back to the cute animal photos. So this is my dog, Hutch. We named her after the place that developed the cure, which is also the place she spent her first 3 years, known by four numbers stamped inside her ear. She was mostly Beagle with a little Basset. She died last year of cancer, but we had eight good years with her. The digits in her ear grew quite faint over time. She was a research animal. Indeed, she received almost the identical transplant conditioning protocol as my daughter. Then Hutch got her own stem cells back, and about 6 months later came home with us. One afternoon, Hutch jumped up on the window seat that she wasn't supposed to be on and rested her head on a Jimmy Fund hat. I let her get away with that so I could take this picture. I let her get away with a lot. Watching my daughter grow up with that dog was like seeing a miracle alongside a metaphor. At the dog park, people would say, "Oh, she's a rescue." And I'd say, no, I'm the rescue. Now at meetings of the Ethics Advisory Committee at Children's Hospital, every time a case comes up concerning parents and physicians at odds over the best interests of a child, I'm yanked back to our decision to leave Boston for Seattle. I'd like to think I've contributed something by writing this book, but in truth, my daughter could probably do without it. She lived the experience and has her own appreciation of what took place to save her life. She did not need my book to do that. I needed to write it, just to make some sense of an experience that is much magical realism as science to me. But I did not need to publish it, and I waited until my daughter was older and it felt okay, or more okay than not. Another balance of benefit and harm. In truth, whether or not to publish might be the most ethically loaded question in my story. Thank you. I'll get that. That's good. Thanks.
Thank you, Paul.
I'll leave Hutch up.
As you can see, he's a very, very thoughtful writer and speaker. If Martha were here, she would tell you that this is a pathography, that is a memoir that uses the experience of a patient or a person connected to a patient of their illness. And so, how many of you have read the book? Fair number. And Paul has sort of started us down the path of answering one of the questions that Martha would have asked, that is, what does this story do for the writer? And there are actually books written about this. One of the most important is a book by Arthur Frank called The Wounded Storyteller. But there are a number of others. Another question, though, is to ask, what does this story do for the reader? Because Paul didn't write this just for his own therapy. He wrote this because he had a purpose in sharing the story. And your purpose in reading it and his purpose in writing it might not match, but it might be interesting to explore that. Just by way of following up on this question about what moral stories or pathographies do for people who write them, and the questions that Paul started to pose at the end of his talk about the ethical considerations in writing about a family member. Those of you who read the book know that he worried about this from the beginning and took care not to write things he and Jody put on care page, for example, that Jay didn't want on there, and also took that into account as he wrote Bloodlines. That's one of the questions that Martha talks about in reviewing a couple of books about pathographies. And so I put a copy of that article up here for any of you who want to pick it up. So in the meantime, let's see if we can start off this conversation from the question of what work does this pathography do for the reader? Those of you who have read it, what did you learn by reading it? I stumped you. If you want to start somewhere else, you may. Lynn.
Well, in such an eloquent way, showed both how much context matters. Because time, I mean, you gave the structure within a time continuum, but also severity continuum, and a person, a character continuum. So you allowed for, in a way, the sensitivity that there are so many perspectives, each one changed by the other person or the time frame, and that there's the patients, the families, the communities, and the healthcare team, and at any one given moment in time, there's usually a discrepancy, whether it's an ethical discrepancy or medical scientific discrepancy. And to me, that was very profound, the way you sort of interwoven all the characters and time frames.
Thank you.
And describe the discrepancy between people giving you advice and how hard it is for families to hear.
It's so different to look back on that retrospectively than in the moment. I mean, it's such chaos in the moment. I mean, you know, what are you even saying? You're learning language. It's crazy. So it's very. In fact, it's interesting to come back and revisit the story I wrote several years ago now, because I'm just, you know, I'm a different person. Things have totally changed, and my perspective on the story is different. I'd write a different book now, but it's
Your description of the new normal was pretty interesting. I don't know how many of you have had children in the hospital, but that really rang true to me, where everything is turned around and suddenly you have to cope with a piece of your world that you never expected, and the language is new and the people are new. And
I remember we even asked a question, I don't remember if it was Jody or I, but something just really awful happened. And one of us asked, you know, is the nurse, is this normal? You know, it was like, hello, you know, but, you know, that was just, that's the way the mind was working.
We made it real. I think that you brought home in a very clear way what it was like, what it is like to be a parent, and to be weighing all of the possibilities.
For those of you in the front, speak up. Sorry. For those of us in the back.
The book made it real, made it a very, it brought to life what it's like to be a parent terrified for their child.
You also weave in an awful lot of information about the people whose work in science labs and medical labs and the animals that contribute their lives and their well-being to that had in the, you know, run-up to the fact that your daughter was able to survive a formerly lethal disease. And in your presentation today, you really sharpened that question about how many people and how many animals and how much tension the researchers absorb in order to get, not always to the good outcome of a successful treatment. I remember, I'm sure Bob remembers, the days of children who were having bone marrow transplants and who had graft versus host disease and were miserable, and more than half of them died. And, you know, I remember the nurses in the ICU developing this quasi-therapy for them that enabled a child to pick a nurse who would have to drink the bowel prep that they had to drink every day as a way of getting through drinking that stuff. And a lot of children died, who would have died, but still. You know, he has asked this question even today about how much harm is it justifiable to do in the hope of getting to a good ending, which this turned out to be.
Right. That's why I've saved that phone message for the longest time. I love that phone. I've tried actually to track her down, but not any success. But that just takes me back to that kind of scenario. I mean, it's that the parent is the one who's saying, do something. You know, it's like, figure this out. You know, figure this out. This is awful. And so there's almost an aspect of ownership that I think, you know, the patient, the family has to take on about this. What are you asking us to do? What are you justifying?
And those of you in research ethics, this blurring of, what's the word I want, level three, research.
Oh, the clinical trials.
Yeah, clinical trials and treatment. Should we blur those lines more or less?
I think it highlights the value and the importance of informed consent, and that it's not a document. It's not something you sign and get over with. It's really a process of communication. And as you say so beautifully, communication is difficult. And I think that those of us who are in this field feel compelled to make that informed consent document, even though it's just one of the components of the informed consent process, be in layman's language. My sort of metric is always, would my husband understand this? He's in business, and he's a bright guy, and if he wouldn't understand it, then it's wrong.
Yeah. I think there's also something that about engaging families with the understanding that they're oftentimes they're trying to, in the heat of the moment, they're trying to give you the answer that you want to hear. So they're not really, informed consent is, I think you can sometimes be the best communicator on the planet and you're still not going to be understood with certain people because they're just, you know, it's just too much to absorb. So, and I'm not sure what to do with that, but.
So, Bob.
You want to follow up on that?
No, that's okay.
One of the things that struck me in listening to you, Paul, was the interplay between emotional detachment and emotional engagement, particularly when I was seeing some of those comments about the researchers. You know, I think whether you're doing research or doing clinical care with critically ill patients, there's maybe a few people that are able to keep those in balance. But I think most of us are oscillating between the two. And that for much of our day or maybe, you know, much of our lives, there's an emotional detachment that enables one to do the work, which is then at times, I think, maybe in private times, balanced with an emotional engagement. But I wonder when, you know, somebody looks at a woman like that and says, you know, a baby killer, you know, you can look like you're being pretty cruel in the moment. And that, you know, you can look like you don't care. And of course, people do. But it's a way of engaging with the world that enables one to keep moving forward from day to day. And I wondered maybe what your experience was in terms of working with the clinicians and the researchers that you did about how they managed those sort of two ways of being in their work.
God, the whole range. And Joe, you can feel free to step in here if you'd like, because you experienced it as much as me. But
I was actually thinking of an example of we had this attending who took care of Daryl the whole way through. She was wonderful. And she's very compassionate. We're talking about Jennifer Wainwright.
Oh,
very
yes,
compassionate,
okay.
Very knowledgeable. We respected her and everything. But I remember we had a healing service at our church. Our church was a big part of what supported us. And I remember we had the healing service. We had lots of neighbors and friends and family. And after the service, we were telling Jennifer about it, and she said, oh, why didn't you invite me? And I was like, oh, I did that separation thing, like just what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. You know, like, she was compassionate and wonderful, but I wonder about, you know, these systems and how they're kept so separate that I didn't think of her as somebody to fold into my church. Of course, you know, now I'm embarrassed that we didn't invite her, but it says something about the separation.
and how tricky that is.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned that, because just at the consortium a week ago or so, Michael Balboni was talking about like those numbers of like almost like, you know, 90% of physicians and nurses can't engage the patient or family on issues of, you know, a religious nature or that, or don't. So there's like there's a wall there that doesn't, I think from both directions maybe, because clearly, you know, Dr. Wangbo never said, you know, don't get into that with me, you know, but we didn't get into that with her, you know, so it's.
You also had the experience that those of you who haven't read the book might not fully grasp or be wondering about, of some clinicians who were very open with you about the difference between what was offered at Dana-Farber Cancer yeah. Institute and Boston Children's and what was possible at Seattle Children's. And I don't, you know what the political costs might be for someone who does that, but I think it's not always routine for clinicians to draw families in to a consideration. And it's partly because you already had family members doing some of that research
right.
and work, and gave you a standing place from which to ask questions about other ways of doing bone marrow transplants. So my question is about how you developed a relationship that enabled your caregivers to share with you information that usually only insiders know about
well,
a variety
I think
of research protocols.
When we were in the process, when we were getting to the point where we knew it was going to be a bone marrow transplant was necessary, and we were in Boston, and starting to gather that information, I think there was kind of a protective area where among Dana-Farber physicians, there's only so far they would go in terms of saying what else is out there, what else is going on. So there was sort of a certain, and some people negotiated that better than others. Some didn't negotiate it well at all, and others said, you know, you really need to, we don't recommend you go anywhere else, but you need to kind of know what else is being done, because there's a whole range of approaches going on right now. This isn't the only one. We believe in this one, and here's why. But so there were people who could, there were physicians who could kind of go there and at least kind of dance along that kind of tricky political line, and there were others who just would be very defensive about it. Very, very defensive about it. But what was remarkable was, Jody's stepmother, Lucy, and Jody really engaged this early on, getting on the phone and exchanging information with people. But it was really striking to me over time how I could get somebody, you know, the head of transplant at Duke, the head of transplant at Oakland Children's, on the phone. And they couldn't give me a lot of time, and they didn't know me, and they didn't know enough of the diagnosis and everything, but they could attach a name, and they knew aplastic anemia needs transplant, and the way they would engage questions and help was really extraordinary. So once you, it was like almost, but you had to cross that sort of political wall of kind of what's, if it's okay to go there or not, you know? Does that make sense?
It does. It does, and I don't think that's a common experience. I think it has at least partly to do with your own abilities to connect with people in a way that enabled them.
And we were really coming from a place of privilege, too. I mean, we had a lot of resources of all kinds, and people to ask, knew the questions to ask, knew where to go with the questions. And so, I mean, if I'd been a single parent dealing with this, it would have been a very, very different story. And things would have been taken care of here. My daughter probably would have had her life saved here, and, you know, with a more toxic treatment. And I maybe would have never known there was anything different.
Um,
Sorry, I haven't read your book yet, but I just had a question.
You don't have to apologize. There's a lot of you.
Yeah. But to go back to the Martha Montello question by way of Christine of the reader versus the writer and what a story does, I was wondering if your daughter has read the book and how, you know, what was her reception to your reflection on her illness and you know, where was the reconciliation, where were the discrepancies, and how did she receive it overall?
Boy, that's a great question. And I'll recruit Jody on this one too. And
yeah, sure.
But it's been a process. You know, I wrote this book a few years ago, the first draft of it, and she knew I was doing this and we'd talk about it, but we didn't really deal with it too much. I just needed to, I was doing this for my own purposes, and she didn't, you know, the thing that my wife and I give her a lot of, my wife a lot of credit for this, is creating an environment when my daughter was really, really sick that kind of normalized it in a way, you know, so she'd never had the experience of being yanked, feeling like she'd been yanked out of her life and things would get back to normal sometime, but right now is awful. I think we, and this was really my wife's doing, creating an environment of where it just, this is my life now, right now, until the next one comes. So, and as a result, this time is kind of a blip on the timeline for my daughter. You know, this doesn't define her life the way it does my wife and I, you know. So I think we were successful in that regard. So we don't actually, my daughter and I don't talk about the book a lot. We come back and forth to it over time. She has, in fact, I didn't give her a copy. I gave her own copy. It has a totally different title. Maybe 2 years ago. And I know she's read some of it. She's never told me I've read all of it. But she did last week. This was just out of left field. It was amazing. She had an assignment for an English class so she asked me if she could interview me, and I didn't know what it was about. And I said, sure. So she sets up her iPad and records this interview. She starts asking me a series of questions about why I wrote the book, and I went into it, you know. And she sat there, and it was great. It was just great dialogue. Then, like 3 days later, she performed in her English class as me, talking about why I wrote the book. I didn't see it, and I don't think it was recorded. So I just know it happened, and so. I don't even know what to make of that, but oh yeah, absolutely. And to sit there with her and be interviewed with her, by her, about this, it was great. It was an amazing conversation. So that's still a work in progress. Go ahead.
She processes things by doing.
Right.
So I think, I'm a psychologist, I can't help myself. I mean, I think part of the way she was processing you doing this, writing a book, is by doing it herself in a way, you know. She had a choice. She didn't have to interview Paul.
Right, right.
And then it reminds me of when she was younger and she was sick and she was 7, she would go, she had 81 blood transfusions. And one of the ways she dealt with it is we amassed this whole box of medical supplies without needles, you know, everything but the needles. And right after a blood transfusion or an IV or a poke, she would go and do it. She'd say, okay, Lucy, Grandma, you know, Christy, Aunt Christy, let me have your arm. We're going to do this now. Okay, we're going to do it, you know, on this. She was repeating and reworking it, and so I think that is one way that she dealt with it, and so there was less left over for her to process, which is just like what Paul said, it's really more of a blip in her life, you know, who knows, she's only 18.
What she really wrestled with it was recently whether she should make it an essay in her college application, and she did, and then she tore it up, and then she was convinced that she ought to again, and so she did, so. She actually wrote an extraordinary essay.
Kind of runs in the family.
When I was 18, I was not writing like that.
I did read the book, Paul.
Thank you.
And hi, Christine.
Hi.
From long ago. And as a nurse educator, I read the book and I was waiting for nurses. And my memory of this, now it's a couple of years ago that I read the book, was that some of your favorite nurses had a grit about them of let's get this done, kind of forward thinking, and cared for both parents as well as child, which I thought was interesting. I've got a couple of copies of your book. A year ago, I was training a graduate student. Oh, used to be hem-onc at Children's, great. I've got a great book for you to read. This was a student of my, a grad student, who seemed a little locked down and cautious. And I thought, Paul's book, we'll talk about it. We'll talk about how she's doing with people that she's seeing now, whose big problem is strep throat or something. And she came back to have a long crying session with me. I don't know why I couldn't keep up doing it. I don't know where I could have gone to grab what I needed as a safety net for myself. And to me, that's important to hear as someone involved in nurse education or people who are here in medical education, to try to figure that out with your best people on the floor, who's watching out for them, and how do you keep them going?
So she had left because the work in hem-onc was...
Yeah, it just got to her. Even in this era, listen, there's always going to be another health problem that we haven't conquered, but you know, it was just that burnout thing. And I think it's something that we have to ponder.
What did you think the book would do for its readers?
You know, I never thought that way about the book.
Yeah.
This was a very, very indulgent book. I wrote it for me. You know, the original, I edited it down to its current length just to make it a more readable, you know, book for others. But in fact, I wasn't sure I was, you know, I self-published, but I wasn't sure I would at one point, just because, you know, it's like my daughter doesn't need to go through this again or have this whole thing relived or in this way. But it was some friends who had read it, and they saw value. So I became convinced that there was something there. But for me to say, I don't know, maybe it just feels too self-serving, but for me to answer that is...
Yeah.
Tricky.
You weren't really thinking about what it would do for other people.
No, I wanted to replay it, and so I could kind of make some sense of it. Because, you know, like I said, it's the story is as much magical realism as it is science. You know, I mean, the sitting there that night, I mean, it was Easter week in 2006, like 11:30 at night on the transplant ward in Seattle, and you know, in comes this pizza delivery guy with the stem cells from the south, you know, in a cooler, and the doctor is, you know, transplant physician is barely even there. He's there and he's paying attention. It's all about the nurses. The nurses are taking care of the whole thing, and they hook it up. And there's this bag of stem cells that they hook up to my daughter. And those things, you know, when I think of transplant, I think of surgery. You know, and it's like, oh, here's this, we're going to take this liver from here and put it over here, and you have to do it just meticulously. But with stem cell transplant, like they hang it up, and these things just go inside, and they know where to go. And it's like, wow, what's up with that? You know, and it's I mean, I don't even know how to explain that. It's just extraordinary. So that sort of thing is what I wanted to try to look at with the book and kind of go, what the hell just happened? You know, my daughter's still here. It's like, what is this?
So in writing it, Paul, was that helpful to both be able to capture that affective experience, but in addition to that, get some distance?
Yeah.
From
yes.
It as
yes.
Well?
Yeah. There was and kind of the it was helpful to write it, and it was helpful to edit it a number of times myself and move things around and cut things and yeah. It was very helpful, just psychologically. You know, I mean, it was therapy for me in so many ways. I mean, I didn't want to, this kind of experience can, you know, it's almost like you have a choice of reparenting. It's like you can kind of look at it clearly and try to find a way forward, or you can just become neurotic as a parent and whatever. It's like, in fact, I love this quote from I used it in my book, the film Finding Nemo, you know, where it's like the Marlin is the father and he's like Albert Brooks, you know, totally neurotic, you know, now he's lost his kid and he can't find him. And he's fishing around and get Ellen DeGeneres is Dory, and she's like total ditz, you know. And they're going around looking for the kids, Marlon says, you know, if I find him, I'll never let anything happen to him ever again. And Dory says, well, that wouldn't be much fun for the little guy. And it's like, oh, okay. And that has stayed with me. You know, it's like I could be very much lost in this. So writing this story really helped me to just kind of allow her to just live her life and not be defined by what took place here.
And you were the person who had to say no over and over again. I assume you did too, but
she
was immune suppressed,
right.
And it was absolutely critical that no one with something that was going to cause her a problem come near her. And
right. Yeah.
So you could have been very protective.
Yeah. And it was. I mean, it's not like I'm sane, you know. It's but I've hung on to some of it, I guess. I hope. But yeah, she, you know, this was a boy in the bubble story, except there's no bubble anymore, you know. And it's kind of how do you protect and, you know, when everything's contagious and everything and even yourself put you at risk, you know, sort of.
So speaking of that, you experienced a difference in cultures between Boston Children's and all the masks and the Purell and the so forth, and Seattle Children's, where before Geraldine had begun to trust this new environment and these new healthcare providers, and maybe you too, things were really different about how protected she was supposed to be from all these germy people around.
Right. And here, and we really became, we experienced this when we were outpatients, but still coming to the CATCR, I can't even remember what that stands for, but for, you know, for blood work and infusions and whatnot. And we'd have to run through the lobby, you know, with her mask on. But it was all about, here it was all about protecting her with the mask and Purell and everything from others. And we got to Seattle, and they told you, you can wear a mask if you want, if it makes you feel more comfortable, but only do it if you got a cold, you know, because we don't want you to infect the others. You know, so it was the total reverse. And that was, I'm not sure which is the better way, but it was just strange. It was, what that was it something I did not know before, is how different things are done from here to here, to Seattle, to New York, to Boston. It's like total different approaches. You know, you kind of think that medicine is medicine, and they all do it the same way, and some do it better than others, but it's just all the same. But that's just not true. And that's kind of that was an eye-opener. And I'm not sure it should be any different, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm glad that Seattle was sort of pushing the envelope in a way and kind of doing this. They had more experience with bone marrow transplant. They did more patients, so they knew more about aplastic anemia, which is a very rare disease, you know. And you know, thank goodness it was a place that really specialized in that, you know. Hey, Charlotte.
Hey, Paul. I too read your book and loved it, and I hope that redeems the fact that I had to get here late. So forgive me if you've already addressed this question, but I'd love to ask if you haven't. One of the fascinating parts of the book was the relationship between the stem cell donor and your family. And this is somebody who identified herself, invited you to her medical school graduation, contributed to the bloodline scheme,
right.
And you do wonderful things with that relationship. I wondered if, you know, as you look back and as it's been more years of relating or not relating to that person, if you would reflect on the importance of knowing the person or not, the possible pitfalls, you know, and anything else about that relationship that you would share.
Yeah, well, I love knowing her, and I'll let Jody address this too. I mean, do you want to, or do you? I mean, I love knowing this woman. We don't see much of her. We are connected on Facebook. She's a quilter, and so very prolific quilter, and I see the quilt she's making all the time, photos of them. So I don't know, and I know, you know, the year or more where we didn't know her or who she was, we were very, very curious, but to know what it would be like not to know her, I'm not sure I could reflect on that, but I love knowing that there was this person who did not know anything about us, except that there was this 8-year-old in Boston, or didn't even know she was in Boston, that there was this 8-year-old with aplastic anemia who needed a transplant. And that was enough for this person to say, okay, I'll go let them shove a needle in my hip and take marrow, and sure. It's like, wow, that's like extraordinary, you know, so.
I remember not knowing why we had to wait a year. We got her through the anonymous bone marrow registry, and you're not supposed to identify yourself for a year. I didn't understand that, and now I get it, because I was putting myself in her shoes, that if the first transplant had not worked, we would be hopeful, you know, looking to her like, can we have another, you know, and how that would put her in a horrible position, and, you know, just the ethics of all that didn't dawn on me until much later. You know, the anonymity was frustrating. Remember, she sent us a card when Jay was on the transplant ward, and it had all the identifying information blocked out. And we looked, like Paul was saying, we're trying to figure out who is this person. And she did the same thing. I sent her a card with, like, for some reason, Museum of Modern Art painting on it, and she's like, oh, they must be from New York, or something. You know, like, she's trying to figure out who we were. But I'm glad that, you know, it all worked out, obviously, but then also glad that it was anonymous, so if it didn't, you know, she wouldn't have felt pressured.
Steve.
Thanks.
So, you know, we started a little with gratitude, so I wanted to connect that, and then what Bob mentioned before about engagement and disengagement, and then add in a little component about compartmentalization and the importance of that as well. You know, part of what you do as a parent, and I should say, as someone that's a long friend, that my daughter's woven in the book, and so it's on a couple levels. But you know, as a parent, what you get you through oftentimes when you're in that circle is trying to think about not wanting to join the group that doesn't survive, that you're engaged with a group that is looking desperately for what is going to survive. What that's about, and so you work hard on that, and I think one of the gifts of, and you have to get through that, you have to be able to kind of be able to put things on the shelf regularly, so you're not fully disengaged, but you can take it down at any time. And then you think about it, think about your book, what I'm very grateful for with your book is that it is a connection between the personal world of the parents and the families and the professional world. And that it bridges that. That oftentimes books are geared either towards just the parents and the families and all of that, or they're geared just towards the professionals. And yours really bridges that. And I think that's really the, to me, that was the gift that you brought that I'd like to thank you for.
Well, thanks. Thank you, Steve. Yeah, we went through a lot of this together. Yeah.
So I want to pick up on the Pinker quote that you showed.
Can you speak up a little?
I'm sorry. I wanted to pick up on the Pinker quote and the sort of willful amnesia that he asks us to have. I think one of the wonderful things about the book is the fairly distressing history of transplant medicine is told in a really deft way. You don't realize you've eaten all that broccoli until really at the end of the book. But I'm interested in this idea of you know, I went to medical school at a time when the Tuskegee information was actually just breaking. And there was a large faction that said, you should never even know about this. This was so shamefully and horribly done. It needs to be suppressed. It's Voldemort. It needs to disappear. The idea that in my profession of child neurology, the names of doctors who discovered things, if they were Nazi fellow travelers, have been expunged. you know, they were to be cast into the outer darkness. And I understand that, but I think that it gets you to the point, I mean, just in your reflection, of Pinker sort of saying, well, we're trustworthy, and if we forget all the stories of untrustworthiness, we sound great. But you did a very good job, I think, of this tension between the costs and the benefits and the difficulty of, and the messiness of the story.
Right. You know,
so
I think.
Should we forget?
Well, no. But you get, you know, I think you need to have eyes wide open on this. What was I going to say? Kind of lost my train here.
You know, if you don't have that history, you're also robbed of the opportunity to be grateful for the sacrifices that were made on the path from the children who didn't survive their bone marrow transplants to the dogs who gave their lives and others in between. And, you know, you started at a point of expanding your gratitude for Jay's survival to include the people who didn't survive and the animals who were sacrificed to get to the point of her survival. And if you don't have that information and you don't have that history, all you're left with is the gratitude that your child survived, but not a recognition of what it took to get that.
And I think the thing that rubs me funny with what Pinker said is that trust is so important to this whole process. I mean, we just allowed things to take place with our daughter, just trusting this system. And they'd be explained to us, but we just had this, okay, if anything, this may not work, but if anything's going to work, this physician, these nurses, they're going to make it work. And, but there was just this real trust, and that's a privilege, I think. It's a real profound privilege. And not everybody has that, and especially if you're on the other end of a, you know, if your memory is of Tuskegee and other times, how are you supposed to buy into that? You know, how are you supposed to give your trust to the system that's, you know, even though you need it desperately, you know, so it's...
Well, I just wanted to say on that issue, my daughter was born with a lot of things wrong with her heart, which was not picked up right away. So she came in as an emergency, and then she was going to have surgery at 2 weeks for about four or five different things. And the night before the surgery, my husband asked the doctor, what are the statistics on the surgery? And he said, being honest, he said, there aren't any. We've never done all of these things at once. And, you know, talk about trust. I mean, what could we do? We could either say, wait, stop, you know, or... But then he said, but what we've learned is that over the years, we've learned that the best chance of survival is to make that heart as close to what it should be as we can, as early as we can. And that's why we think it's really worth doing this, and we think it'll work. But I felt like he gave us the whole picture as best as he could, and it was a very humanizing moment for, you know, this surgeon to be to us. He was, and it was important, and we were so grateful to him.
Thank you.
I'll ask another, since others aren't. So, you know, Paul, you know, anyone who's gone through the events that you have, and especially somebody who's written about them, I'm sure gets asked by other people for your advice, or, you know, let me tell you my story, and then they look to you expectantly. What insights can you give me? How do you think about that when you talk to others? What part of your story can be helpful to others? Obviously, it's been helpful to a lot of us. But where do you set boundaries around how you share personal advice or insights with others?
That's a great question, because I actually had a conversation 2 months ago with a young guy at Children's, come to town for aplastic anemia, needing a transplant, and going through some of the issues that we had, and was Dr. Wangbo said, you might talk to these people, and so I did. I'm not sure I told him anything that was helpful. I think that listening to him was helpful. I don't remember what he, there was a couple of things he said that I responded to that I can't even remember to tell you here. But more than that, I heard what he was going through and kind of shared in that. And I think that was more important than anything I told him. And in fact, I think I probably could have been hurtful to talk. When we were through that 10 years ago, this is what happened. And, I would put the fear of God in the poor guy, So I didn't want to stomp on his hope, and I didn't want to give him false hope. But listening, I think, was the best thing I could do there.
Well, this is an increasingly used strategy, and sometimes ethics consults recommend it, that the team might consider families who are facing difficult medical, ethical choices, talking with other family members who've been through it. And, you sort of point to exactly the pitfalls of, what does a family member being asked to do that say to someone who's facing a choice where their child's life and well-being is at stake? And, we've talked about, so do you introduce them only to the ones who had surgery that went well, a bone marrow transplant that worked? Do you give them one of each? Do you,
I think you probably need to have a sense of who that person is you're handing off to them. If you can help a person in that situation with anything, it's sort of to get them comfortable with the uncertainty and the ambiguity of it, and you can do everything right and your kid can die, or a lot of things went wrong in my daughter's treatment and she survived. You'd think nothing ever happened. But sitting with that kind of ambiguity isn't easy, but I think maybe talking to someone and listening to them, maybe you can make some progress with that. But there's no magic thing to say to somebody in a situation like that. I remember our minister came by the church one time, came by the hospital on 7 West, and it was like, I don't need this conversation. I just don't need this conversation right now, And he knew enough to turn around and go away, but there's nothing in the world he could have said. But don't say if it's a parent, who's going to tell you, your kid's gone to a better place. Don't cut that person off right away.
Well, you and Steve kind of had each other. But there are. I don't know if there have been conversations in the ethics committee while Paul has been on it about that kind of recommendation. But ethics consult teams do agonize a little bit sometimes about this, and particularly around advanced fetal care center cases, but some others too. And it is an N of one, or if you give them the names or you introduce them to more than one parent, it's still only a couple. And it's hard to tell how beneficial.
Is it going to do more harm than good?
We've left it vague at times at Columbia of saying, particularly in the prenatal setting, of saying there's so much uncertainty. We're as healthcare providers as uncertain as you are, and recognize the unbearable tension because of it. You may want to speak to families, not going on the internet, but actually speaking to families who have been in similar situations. I don't recall us ever saying, here's a person to speak with, for that very reason, because you just have no idea, regardless of what the end result is, of success or not, the process that they went through. They're all different.
I could just comment on that and then turn to something from our ethics committee that Paul just contributed to in a big way based on this book. But quickly on that question, I feel that if you look at the shared decision-making projects coming out of Dartmouth and other places, when they do have you know, people on videos talking about their experience, and they try to have someone who chose this side and is happy about it, and one who isn't so happy, someone who took the other alternative and is happy and is not happy. And I think you can figure you want to vet your people and you want to balance it. I don't know how feasible that is in a separate hospital setting, but it's worth, I think your question is really important because these people can have a huge influence. And Paul was more modest about the influence he was having. He was listening more than talking, but yeah, it's an important question. What I wanted to mention is a little bit earlier, I think it was your question, Christine, you touched on with Paul the issue of people at Children's Hospital telling him about what was going on in Seattle, even though that wasn't being offered at Children's or recommended. And we were just in our last ethics committee meeting talking about whether there's actually an obligation for clinicians to inform people, even if you're then going to say, we don't offer it, here's why, we're not recommending it, but a reputable place is doing this, and in fact, and it turned out Children's was close to beginning to offer it. Is there perhaps an ethical obligation to inform? And I would say, David, would you agree? Our committee felt pretty strongly that there was an obligation in a situation like that, similar to the argument that Chris Buehler makes in that great paper where he talks about the difference between informing a patient, offering the treatment, and recommending the treatment from among the great options that you're offering. But I think Paul's story really illustrated for people the importance of that right.
That's so interesting. And is there a way, what Children's Hospital's Ethics Committee thinks, informs all the clinicians on the front line who are making decisions about enrolling families in phase three trials and considering alternative treatments know about your sense of their obligation?
So my sense of that, my closest friend in medical school is from Oklahoma, and he said, you know, when we need to change the direction of the stampede, we don't stand in front of it and yell, stop cows.
Did you all hear that?
No.
My closest friend in medical school, still one of my closest friends, was from Oklahoma. And he said, you know, back home, David, when we have a stampede, we don't stand in front of it and yell, stop, cows. You just get next to it and you just kind of lean. And if you do that long enough, they turn. I think that's our model.
Along that line, there's the Department of Public Health has regulatory changes that are going into effect actually really shortly that will require all clinicians for all of us to talk with patients about all of their options if they are facing anything that is a life-threatening illness. And this includes chronic illnesses. It includes the criteria, basically, if you would not be surprised if the person were to not survive during the next year. You're then obligated to give alternatives to whatever care you are offering, including palliative care and hospice. So it's all the various range of, and so it's big question is going to be how it gets operationalized. Mm-hmm. Right? You know, but that's going in. That's it.
I had one other thought on back to Bob's question. One of the more for me, it might have been the most important conversation in the whole process was with Akiko Shimamura early on. And where she was explaining just kind of what we were facing, and the kind of the the disease was idiopathic. They never did know what caused it, and she was, and which was I could not wrap my head around that. But she just eloquently explained, you know, there's a lot that I know, and then there's a lot that I don't know, but I know it's there, that I don't know. And then there's this other pile, there's like this all this unknown unknowns. You know, and I'd rather remember Akiko saying that than Donald Rumsfeld, I think. but it was really an important just to hear that. You know, all of it she did not know. And it was like, oh, okay, we're kind of in this adventure together then, I guess.
I think another ethical dilemma is your insurance will cover this, but not that. We're not in that other state. And that must be very difficult for someone who's a scientist and the surgeon or the oncologist.
Yeah. Well, it is unfortunately 2 o'clock. I really want to thank you, Paul.
Oh, thank you.
In a way, what you are doing is a little bit like what could perhaps be called translation bioethics, in the sense that we spend a lot of time, and the students will attest to this for the foundations course, talking about the academic and theoretical components of bioethics that you must grasp in order to be prepared to do the kind of work that you will eventually be doing. But it is very easy to lose track of your feelings and your perceptions and the sense of being the parent or the patient or the family member. And in a way, you have, by Bloodlines and the work that you're doing with the Community Ethics Committee and Catalyst, serving in a way that bridging, so that people see it's not all about the Enlightenment and theoretical bioethics and philosophy alone, but it's also about those moral intuitions and the human behavior of grappling with what life hands us, about which we each have to make moral choices, and some of them with very, very high stakes. So we want to thank you for
thank
that.
Thank you. Nicely put. Thank you all for coming. I guess I have the answer to the question, why did you write the book? Well, this. So thanks. Thank you.